Leia here from leiaforsci.com/MCAT, and in this video, we'll look at the hemoglobin-oxygen dissociation curve from a perspective of understanding for the standard curve and then the right shift and left shift. In video 1, we introduced the concept of hemoglobin and that oxygen binding is cooperative, which we compared to pair pressure. So let's take a look at what happens. When you're graphing hemoglobin-oxygen dissociation, or hemoglobin-oxygen affinity, you want your y-axis to represent the percent saturation. And specifically, we're looking at the percentage of hemoglobin molecules that are saturated, meaning that are bound to oxygen. But keep in mind, there's also a lot of free-floating oxygen that's simply dissolved in the blood. For the x-axis, we're looking at the pressure of O2, which is measured in millimeters of mercury. When you're looking at the concentration of a gas, you can look at it from the perspective of pressure, which is force over area. So the more oxygen or the more gas that's dissolved, the higher your pressure. Or you can look at it as a molarity. But here, the pressure is actually referring to the concentration because we're looking at how much oxygen is dissolved to give us that pressure. Hemoglobin naturally does not like oxygen. So if you're starting at a very low pressure of O2, starting with zero, and you slowly dissolve more oxygen, you slowly increase the pressure of O2, you'll see a very slight increase in the percent saturation because hemoglobin does not like oxygen, especially in the T state. But as the pressure increases, you'll start to get an oxygen molecule here and there that gets forced into binding out of just the sheer volume of oxygen molecules. And suddenly, hemoglobin goes from not liking oxygen to suddenly really wanting oxygen because of that peer pressure, because of that cooperativity. And you see that with a very sharp increase in the curve as more and more and more oxygen is binding for every slight increase in pressure. Until you get to the point when most of the hemoglobin is full, and even though you increase the concentration of oxygen, you can't really fill any more sites because there aren't any more sites to fill. And that's where you get that near plateau where it tapers off, and you'll see that asymptote as the concentration will cause a very slight increase, but you don't see any significant change. If you want to compare this to what you understand for enzyme activity, just think of it as reaching the Vmax, where it doesn't matter if you increase the substrate, you're at the maximum capacity for that protein. We're not looking at numbers here because we want to understand it logically, conceptually. But I do want you to look at the halfway point. If we look at the pressure, that gives us a 50% saturation, meaning half of the hemoglobin molecules are bound to oxygen. We call that the P50. And this is a good way to understand the affinity for oxygen at any given concentration or any type of condition. Instead of looking at the top or the bottom of the curve, just find that halfway saturation point, that P50, and then look at how that compares to another type of graph. Is the shift to the right or is the shift to the left? Notice that the shape of this curve is following the letter S. It kind of looks like an S because it is a sigmoidal curve. And this is the characteristic curve that you're going to see for cooperative binding. This contrasts to a very similar molecule, myoglobin. Myoglobin follows a standard binding where at a low concentration, it just starts to pick up those oxygen atoms and then it just tapers out as it gets to the top. Myoglobin is a monomer. It just has one polypeptide chain. Hemoglobin is a tetramer and the tetramer has four units that influence each other. Myoglobin will easily pick up oxygen at a low concentration. But unlike hemoglobin, it won't let go unless the cells are desperate and starving for oxygen, and then it begrudgingly lets go of the oxygen. The myoglobin curve is what you're used to seeing for a standard enzyme or protein, and notice that the shape is not sigmoidal. It simply starts out with a nice slope and then tapers off. We mentioned that there are different molecules that will shift the hemoglobin oxygen saturation curve. Some will shift it to the right and some will shift it to the left. But a lot of students will hear this and memorize. I don't want you to do that. So what I want to do first is look at what happens when there's a right shift, what happens when there's a left shift, and what this means logically. And once you understand it, it'll be much easier to understand why a high concentration of CO2 shifts in one direction, a low concentration of H plus ions shifted in the other direction. We'll start by analyzing a right shift. A right shift means that the curve is going to shift over completely to the right. So we start out at the same zero, because when there is no oxygen, there's no binding. But now the curve is going to go slightly towards the right. And that means that rise you're used to seeing shows up more to the right on the graph, and eventually it too will reach that asymptote. What does it mean when it's shifted to the right? Let's take a look at the P50 value. The P50 is still at that same location, but for this right-shifted graph, it takes a much higher concentration of O2 to reach 50% saturation. And what this is telling you is that if hemoglobin is less willing to accept oxygen, you have to put in so much more oxygen for it to finally accept the oxygen enough to reach a 50% saturation. So a right shift represents a lower oxygen affinity. If we look at that same graph, and now we want to see what it looks like when the O2 concentration is the same that previously gave us the P50, look at that difference. We have a much, much lower percent saturation for an oxygen concentration that previously gave us 50% saturation. When the graph shifts to the right, you have a much lower affinity for oxygen, and hemoglobin is in a state where it wants to let go of oxygen rather than pick up new oxygen. Now what happens if I take the same hemoglobin curve, but I shift it to the left? Once again, we'll start out at that same zero point, but this time we're going to see the increase happening much earlier on the graph. It's more to the left compared to the initial graph because it's left shifted. And here we see the increase in binding, and eventually we reach that same asymptote. Once again, let's analyze what happened. If you look at the P50, you'll notice that it happens at a much, much, much lower concentration of oxygen compared to the standard hemoglobin curve. And that means with just a slight increase in concentration, the hemoglobin that is left shifted is picking up so much oxygen, the affinity for oxygen is so much higher. And if we look at the same left shift curve, and we want to see what it looks like when the oxygen concentration is the same as what previously gave us a P50 for our standard hemoglobin, we're nearly at the top. This hemoglobin is nearly maxed out, and it's reaching that full hemoglobin saturation, meaning it's carrying as much oxygen as it can because it has such a high affinity for oxygen. So now the question is, when do we see a standard curve? When does it shift to the right, and when does it shift to the left? And the answer is that it's constantly changing. The hemoglobin curve is dynamic, and that's how you want it to be for the survival of an organism. You want hemoglobin to go to the lungs and have a very high oxygen affinity so that it grabs all the available oxygen molecules before it leaves. And as it leaves the lungs, you want the oxygen affinity to decrease so that as the hemoglobin travels through the bloodstream, it starts to give away that oxygen. But even more so, you want to have a super low affinity when hemoglobin reaches actively respiring cells. If cells are actively metabolizing, they need a lot more oxygen, and you want to make sure that that is when hemoglobin knows to let go of as much oxygen as possible so that these cells will get the oxygen they need to carry out their metabolic processes. So what causes the hemoglobin to shift to the right, giving it a lower affinity for oxygen? A right shift will be brought on by numerous factors, including a high proton concentration, meaning a low pH, a high CO2 concentration from respiring cells releasing carbon dioxide into the blood, a low oxygen concentration, which is expected away from the lungs, high temperature, and elevated levels of the molecule 2,3-BPG, which you'll also see as DPG. And what makes this curve shift to the left? We'll expect the exact opposites. If we have a low proton concentration, meaning an elevated pH, a low concentration of carbon dioxide, such as when it's exhaled in the lungs, a high concentration of oxygen, because we expect a high concentration in the lungs, lower or resting temperatures, and a lower concentration of 2-3 BPG or DPG. Be sure to join me in the next video where we start to break down the effect of each individual component to understand how and why it causes the curve to shift to the right and left. Are you stuck on a specific MCAT topic? I offer private online tutoring where I focus on your needs to strengthen your individual weaknesses. Tutoring details can be found using the link below or by visiting my website, layoffersci.com/MCAT tutor. Are you overwhelmed by the sheer volume of information required for the MCAT? Are you worried that lack of a proper study plan and low MCAT score will prevent you from getting into medical school? My new ebook, The MCAT Exam Strategy, a 6-week guide to crushing the MCAT, will help you formulate a concrete study plan by helping you figure out where you stand now, identify your goals, and figure out what it takes to reach them. And it's yours free when you sign up for my email newsletter at MCATExamStrategy.com. By signing up for my email newsletter, you'll also be the first to know when I have new videos, MCAT study guides, cheat sheets, tips, and so much more. The link again, MCATExamStrategy.com.